In this lecture, we are going to cover pharmacology of antipsychotics. So, antipsychotics are a class of drugs used primarily to treat psychotic disorders, such as schizophrenia, mania due to bipolar disorder, and severe depression. Now, in order to gain better understanding of mechanism of action of antipsychotic drugs, first we need to discuss the role of dopamine in the development of psychosis. So, the monoamine neurotransmitter, dopamine, plays a key role in the so-called dopamine hypothesis, which argues that the unusual behavior and experiences associated with psychosis can be largely explained by changes in dopamine function in the brain. Now, dopamine has four major pathways by which it affects the brain. Number one, the mesolimbic pathway, which is thought to be hyperactive in schizophrenia and to mediate positive symptoms of psychosis, such as delusions and hallucinations. Number two, mesocortical pathway, which is thought to be underactive in schizophrenia and thus mediate negative psychotic symptoms, such as loss of motivation and social withdrawal. Number three, the nigrostriatal pathway, which is part of the extrapyramidal nervous system and controls motor function and movement. Deficiency of dopamine in this pathway can lead to dystonia and Parkinsonian symptoms, while excess of dopamine can lead to hyperkinetic movements such as tics and dyskinesias. The last major pathway, number four, is the tuberoinfundibular pathway, which controls prolactin secretion. Specifically, dopamine in this pathway inhibits prolactin release. And as a reminder, prolactin is a hormone that enables milk production and is also involved in the control of sexual desire and regulation of immune system. Now, within those different pathways, dopamine interacts with specific receptors that mediate functional effects of dopamine. There are five primary types of dopamine receptors, known as D1, D2, D3, D4, and D5. Out of the five, D1 and D2 receptors are found in the highest density in nearly all of the pathways involved in psychotic disorders. However, D2 receptors are the most clinically relevant because they are the main targets of antipsychotic drugs. Now, antipsychotics can be grouped into older, first-generation agents, known as typicals, and the newer, second-generation agents, known as atypicals. The first-generation typical antipsychotics all share the same main therapeutic goal, that is to block D2 receptors. Furthermore, typical antipsychotics are not selective for any of the four dopamine pathways, and thus will block D2 receptors in almost all areas of the brain. This has positive as well as negative consequences. So, blockade of dopamine receptors in the mesolimbic pathway reduces positive symptoms, such as delusions and hallucinations, which is beneficial. However, blockade of dopamine receptors in the mesocortical pathway that is already underactive in schizophrenia may cause worsening of negative symptoms and thus lead to diminished energy, lack of motivation, restrictions in emotional and verbal expressiveness, and social disengagement. Furthermore, blockade of dopamine receptors in the nigrostriatal pathway may lead to extrapyramidal disorders, tardive dyskinesia, and Parkinson's-like symptoms, such as tremors, muscle rigidity, and difficulty in starting and stopping movements. Lastly, blockade of dopamine receptors in the tuberoinfundibular pathway may cause increase in blood prolactin levels, which then may lead to galactorrhea, gynecomastia, and sexual dysfunction. Now, based on their affinity for D2 receptors, typical antipsychotics are often subclassified as high potency or low potency. The examples of high potency antipsychotics are haloperidol, fluphenazine, prochlorperazine, and trifluoperazine. The example of low potency antipsychotic is chlorpromazine. So generally speaking, the high potency agents produce stronger antipsychotic effect at relatively low doses. However, they also tend to cause more extrapyramidal side effects and greater increase in prolactin levels. On the other hand, the less selective low-potency agents do not bind to D2 receptor as tightly as the high-potency agents and generally affect a range of other receptors, including alpha-adrenergic, cholinergic, and histamine receptors. This can result in a variety of side effects. For example, blockade of alpha-adrenergic receptors can lead to orthostatic hypotension. Blockade of muscarinic receptors can lead to anticholinergic symptoms, such as dry mouth, blurred vision, difficulty urinating, and constipation. And blockade of H1 histamine receptors can lead to sedation and some weight gain. Now let's move on to the second generation atypical antipsychotics. In contrast to typical antipsychotics that primarily block only D2 receptors, atypical agents appear to block both D2 receptors as well as serotonin receptors subtype 2A. Because serotonin inhibits dopamine release, agents that block serotonin receptors may increase dopamine levels in brain areas that need it. Furthermore, atypicals occupy D2 receptors transiently and dissociate quickly, allowing for relatively normal dopamine neurotransmission. This modest D2 receptor blockade in combination with serotonin receptor blockade is thought to significantly lower the incidence of extrapyramidal side effects, as well as decrease negative symptoms and improve cognition compared to typical agents. The examples of atypical antipsychotics are aripiprazole, clozapine, lurasidone, olanzapine, quetiapine, risperidone, and ziprasidone. Now, in addition to dopamine and serotonin 2A receptor blockade, atypical antipsychotics also bind to many other targets, including other subtypes of serotonin receptors, as well as histamine, alpha-adrenergic, and muscarinic receptors. As a result, the side effects of second-generation agents can vary depending on the drug's receptor binding profile. So, for example, atypical antipsychotics that have strong affinity for serotonin receptors subtype 2C, such as clozapine and olanzapine, may cause metabolic side effects, including weight gain, hyperglycemia, and dyslipidemia. Agents that have strong affinity for H1 receptors, such as clozapine, olanzapine, and quetiapine, may cause sedation and may also contribute to weight gain. Agents that have significant affinity for alpha-1 adrenergic receptors, such as clozapine and risperidone, may cause orthostatic hypotension. In addition to that, out of all second-generation agents, risperidone seems to have the strongest affinity for D2 receptors, and because of that, it has the highest potential to induce extrapyramidal side effects and hyperprolactinemia. Lastly, clozapine is the only antipsychotic that can cause serious condition called agranulocytosis that occurs when the bone marrow does not produce enough white blood cells called granulocytes. Because this condition can be fatal, periodic blood cell counts must be performed to ensure patient safety. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.